It's folks we've met that are connected to our greatest regret. I don't know what your greatest regret is, but I bet you weren't alone, right? I don't know what your greatest regrets are, but chances are you weren't alone. Or if you were alone, it was still connected to a relationship. And this is such a strange thing because our greatest regrets involve people oftentimes. And the people they involve, they're not our enemies. They're not people that we're hostile with. I mean, we're on our guard around people that, you know, they have hostility toward us. But they're usually with our friends. Our greatest regrets are usually connected with people we've met and we considered those people friends. That's something to think about. Now, the pushback today a little bit, just to kind of jump ahead, is that as I'm talking, you may be tempted to think, gosh, this you're being so judgmental because we're talking about your friends. These are my friends. These are the people I work with. They've been in my life a long time. And it sounds like you're asking me to be judgmental. So I want to talk about that right up front because this is a big, big deal. This is not about being judgmental. This talk today is about exercising good judgment. And there's a big difference, and I want to explain the difference real quick, and then we'll jump into this content. Being judgmental is me forming an opinion about you. So if I'm judgmental, I've set myself up as a judge, and I'm judging your behavior. I judgmental is when I draw like a critical or maybe a harsh conclusion about you, expecting you to act or be different. But good judgment is different. Good judgment is about me. Good judgment is about drawing conclusions about my life. Good judgment is, in light of my past experience, the things that are most tempting to me, where I've been in the past, what happened in that last relationship, that last marriage, the way I grew up, in light of my past experience, in light of my current circumstances, I'm really mad, current circumstances, just broke up, current circumstances, just started this new job, in light of my current circumstances, in light of my future hopes and dreams, what is the best thing, or what is the wisest thing, not for everybody else to do, I'm not judging you, what you do is none of my business, what is the wise thing for me to do? Judgmental assumes something about the other person. This is all about you. This is how you should respond in light of your future hopes and dreams. So what your mama knew and what you know is that this is a thing that our friends determine the direction and quality of our lives. Let me say it this way, that the thing that makes friendship marvelous is also the thing that makes it so hazardous and so dangerous. Now, if your experience doesn't prove this to you or that's not enough evidence, my assistant sent me an article last week because she knew I was talking about this, and it's an article written by a neuroscientist, Morin Cerf, who is a professor at Northwestern University. And for years, for over 10 years, he has been studying relationships and decision-making and the relationship of decision-making on relationships. And here's what he has discovered, that what we have observed about people influencing other people isn't just behavioral, it's actually neurological, that something happens in your brain. In fact, in this study, they've discovered that our brain waves, that the brain waves of people when they spend time together actually begin to look identical. That the brain waves, before the behavior, before the attitude change, there is something that happens on the inside in our brains when we spend time with other people. Brain waves begin to line up. Now, that's kind of scary. That can encourage you or discourage you. Here's what he says, a couple of statements from the article. He says, the more we study engagement, we see time and time again that just being next to certain people actually aligns your brain with them. He says, this isn't just behavioral. This is neurological. He goes on and he says this, and this is pretty powerful. If people want to maximize happiness, that's me, and minimize stress, that's you. Don't we all want to maximize happiness and minimize stress? Look at this conclusion he draws. They should build a life that requires fewer decisions. How? By surrounding themselves with people who embody the traits they prefer. That if you surround yourself with people who embody, that is, live out the traits you prefer, he says, without any effort, without any decision on your part, your brain will begin to line up with the people who are becoming the kind of person that you ultimately want to be. Now think about that. Last statement, he says this. He says, over time, they'll naturally pick up on those desirable attitudes and behaviors. But the flip side is true as well. Over time, you can pick up on undesirable attitudes and behaviors. With no effort, just being in proximity, simply doing life with, being with people who are moving in a particular direction, something happens in your brain and in my brain. Now, is that judgmental? No, that's just true. This isn't about judgmental. This is about exercising good judgment. If this happens automatically, what should you do? If this happens automatically, how do I harness that? How should I respond? This isn't about being judgmental. Come on, look up here. This is about your future. Your future will be impacted by the people that you do life with. Now, interestingly enough, 3,000 years ago, before we were able to look at the brain, King Solomon, Israel's third king, you know, there was Saul and David, and then his son Solomon became king, considered one of the wisest men who've ever lived. Some people say the wisest man who will ever live. 3,000 years ago, he makes a statement that punctuates what we have finally discovered. 3,000 years ago, here's what Solomon wrote. He said, "Walk with the wise, and you automatically, with no effort, no intentionality, you don't have to write anything down, you don't have to remember anything, you don't have to study for a test. Walk with the wise, and you will, over time, become wise." It's just gonna happen automatically. Now, what is wisdom? We've talked about this. Wisdom is somebody who understands that life is connected, that the dots connect, that my past connects to my present, which is gonna be some sort of predictor of my future. That's what wisdom is. And he says, if you spend time with wise people, over time, you will become wise. That wisdom is contagious. Imagine that. It just rubs off. Do life with the wise, and you will be wise. And then there's a second part of this, for, or the way I memorized this a long, long time ago, the word was but, because it's a contrast. He says, but, or for, a companion of fools ultimately suffers harm. Now, we don't use the word fool because, you know, you don't want to call someone a fool, but in the Jewish Bible, in the Jewish scriptures, a fool was a person who did not live carefully. A fool was somebody who did not understand about how the past connects to the present that's a predictor of the future. A fool is somebody that just lives for the day. But the interesting thing about what Solomon said is what he doesn't say. Let me read it to you again. Walk with the wise and you become wise. Okay, if I hang out with wise people, I become wise. You would expect him to say, hang out with fools and you'll become a fool, but he doesn't say that. What Solomon says is that it's worse than that. Because if you spend time with, surround yourself with, do life with fools, over time, you're not simply gonna become a fool, you're going to suffer harm. That is, when their life goes bad, it's a proximity thing. The closer you are to them, the greater the odds that something bad happens to you. As they go, you go. To which we say, yeah, but I don't do what they do. To which Morin Cerf, the neuroscientist, would say, yeah, but stick around them long enough and you probably will, because your brain waves are gonna line up. So Solomon says it's worse than becoming a fool. You're actually gonna catch the shrapnel from their bad decisions. In other words, friends, this is what Solomon's saying, friends who aren't careful with their lives won't be careful with your life, right? Friends who aren't careful with their health, they're not gonna be concerned about your health. Friends who aren't careful with their marriages, they're not gonna be careful and try to guard your marriage. Friends who aren't careful with their finances, they're not gonna try to guard and be careful with your finances. Friends who aren't all that concerned about their reputation, they're not gonna be all that concerned about your reputation. Friends who don't have any kind of faith or don't have any concerns about faith aren't gonna be very concerned about your faith. And friends who don't seem to care about the future, the last thing they're gonna worry about is your future. This is good judgment. This is a big deal. And this isn't about middle school and high school. This is about all of us. Friends who don't take care of themselves won't take care of yourself. Friends who lie and cheat, you know this. Friends who lie and cheat, they feel better when you what? Lie and cheat. So again, friendship can be awesome, but friendship can be treacherous. Friendship requires some guardrails. Hey, thanks so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please make sure you check out the links on your screen for what to watch next, and check out the description below, where we are going to provide you with free resources designed to help you make better decisions and live with fewer regrets. And again, thanks for watching.